Long before Special Operations Forces and Navy SEALs became household terms in the U.S., Admiral Eric Olson was among these quiet professionals performing the most difficult tasks in the most difficult circumstances, serving his remarkable career in the shadows.
This is the world at night. I was drawn to this image when I was the commander of Special Operations Command and responsible for advising the Secretary of Defense and the President on the global deployment and employment of Special Operations Forces. And I was struck by this composite image, by the reality that our strategic thinking had been throughout my career, that the important places on Earth were where the lights are on at night. We were pretty good at speaking French, Spanish, Italian, Russian, but we weren't good at all at speaking Pashto, Dari, Urdu, Igbo, Swahili. And so we had to really get our legs up under us quickly, and that system, frankly, doesn't support that very well. Technology doesn't support that very well. This is a human business, and we found ourselves behind. We found ourselves behind not only in sort of the simple things, although they're extremely difficult simple things, like learning the language, but we found ourselves woefully behind in terms of our understanding of those places, how things really work. Who's really important? How is money really made? What's the effect of climate, terrain, religion on this place? And I don't mean this big place. I mean this micro place. Valley by valley, village by village. The cultures are different. The motivators are different. And we simply didn't understand that. Frankly, we're still struggling to catch up. But it's a world that behaves according to a different set of factors than our Cold War pre-9-1-1 world, about population, about urbanization, about literalization, about competition for energy, about competition for minerals, competition for water, persecution that leads to extreme behavior in many forms, disparity between rich and poor, crime and corruption and patronage. These may be technicians seeking a cure for cancer, and they may be seeking the next strain of biological weapon of mass destruction. They may be doing their homework, or they may be trying to hack into your computer. And I don't mean to describe them all as threats. I don't even mean to imply that they're all negative. They are just factors in a changing world that will impact us, impact our children as we move forward. And it is beginning to impact how the Department of Defense, how militaries think about how to approach the world in which we live. As a commander, I asked the guys to put together a picture of the world. You're not supposed to be able to read any of this. Just get a sense that it's a very interconnected world. Reds are negative trends, think drug trade. And greens are positive or neutral trends, think academic exchanges. If it's inside a red diamond, it's either crime, migration, or extremism, three factors that generally require some kind of a response regionally or internationally. Where they come together, it creates real friction. I thought this paints a picture of a very non-bipolar world, and I teach at Columbia University. Last semester, I went back to the same guys who did this, and I said, hey, have you guys updated that slide that I'd like to use in my class? And they sent me this. And reality is that there are so many trends and linkages and connectivities in the world that it just requires us to think about an entirely different way. I expand on that a bit. But one of the ways I think about it is that we're in such an interconnected world, we're much less likely to see industrial strength warfare between states. Not that that's not a threat, not that we don't need to be prepared for it, but it's much less likely than the other kinds of war, the resource wars, the cyber wars, the wars in places that we don't understand and with people who are so different from us. Here's a bit of it. These are Russian Spetsnaz in Crimea in civilian clothes, sneaking into Crimea and establishing a presence before the Crimeans could respond in any significant way to it. It was a classic special operation. And here is Boko Haram in Nigeria, who seized 278 girls. This is military looking like civilian. This is non-military looking very, very military. It's a crazy world of threat that we need to prepare for.
When the history of these wars is written, the first, last, and most pivotal chapters will be about Eric and the people he has led and trained and mentored his entire adult life.
It's a human vision, legacy we want to leave behind us.